This is a National Arts Center podcast.
Hello, welcome to Insights, a series of thought-provoking discussions that features leaders in arts, science, and technology. Arts, Medicine, and Life is hosted by award-winning medical educator Dr. Jillian Horton that features doctors speaking about their area of interest and expertise. Thank you to Scotiabank, MD Financial Management, and the Canadian Medical Association for their generous support of this podcast. This episode is recorded live online due to the ongoing current pandemic. Dr. Jillian Horton hosts Olympic gold medalist, author, and motivational speaker Hayley Wickenheiser in a discussion outlining medicine's blind spots and the cognitive shifts we need to make in order to survive the ordeal of the current pandemic. Let's listen in.
Good evening. And welcome to a broadcast in our series, Arts, Medicine, Life, hosted by the digital platform at the National Arts Center. I am the host of this series, Dr. Jillian Horton. I'm a general internist and a writer at the University of Manitoba here in Winnipeg. And before we begin our show tonight, I want to express my thanks to the people at the National Arts Center, the wonderful team who make broadcasting on our national digital platform possible. And I also want to express my thanks to our series sponsor, the Canadian Medical Association, as well as Scotiabank and MD Management. So thank you for making this series possible and our presentation tonight. If you are anything like me, you are sick of hearing the word unprecedented when it comes to talking about COVID and its impact on healthcare. And yet the reality is that this is unprecedented. And sometimes in healthcare, it feels like we are surging forwards with no mental map of what comes next. So then the question becomes, who can offer us a map? And who among us has the dual experience of understanding the realities of healthcare and some of the other chronic circumstances that demand the highest level of physical and mental performance? And not just over months, but over years. So tonight, I am absolutely delighted to be sitting down with Canadian legend Hayley Wickenheiser, who is unequivocally one of the best female hockey players in the world. With 7 world championships, 6 Olympic appearances, 5 Olympic medals, and 4 Olympic gold medals, Hayley is an absolute titan in the sport and a leader both on and off the ice. But what does a 4-time Olympic medalist, gold medalist, do for a second act in life? Well, in Hayley's case, she has decided to go to medical school. And Hayley is currently in her final year of medical studies at the University of Calgary. So Hayley is an inductee into the Hockey Hall of Fame. She's a member of the Order of Canada. She's a member of the IOC Athletes Commission and a founder of the Canadian Tire Hayley Wickenheiser World Female Hockey Festival. And she's also vice chair of the Calgary 2026 bid committee, as well as a mother to a teenage son. So Hayley, I want to welcome you to the digital platform for the National Arts Center and thank you for taking time out of your schedule today.
Thanks for having me, Dr. Horton. It's good to be with you.
Oh, it's amazing. So I know that you have a master's degree in kinesiology. And I know that some of your work at other points in your life has involved working with children with autism. Mm-hmm. But I'd like to ask you to begin by taking us very briefly on the journey from Olympian to soon to be doctor. I mean, after so many years of Olympic success and presumably an infinite number of other paths open to you, why did you choose professionally to start over and become a doctor?
Yeah, well, you know, a lot of people ask me that that question. Why do you want to start medicine at the age of 39? And the answer is that I've always wanted to go into medicine. I grew up in a very small town in Saskatchewan, Shaunavon, Saskatchewan. And I had two loves. I mean, hockey was my first love for sure. But I really got interested in medicine when I was about 10 years old. My parents were both school teachers and my dad taught science. And I just love the human body and love to experiment and to learn a lot about that. So it was always on my radar. And I spent just as much time in the training room with the team doctors and the trainers through the years on the national team as I probably did in the dressing room with my teammates. I was always, somebody would get injured or get cut, I'd be right in there just trying to learn what was happening and see what was going on. So it was just always an interest for me. And I knew, you know, one thing that women's hockey players, I think, have going for them is that we don't make millions of dollars and you're thinking about a life after sport. Whereas a lot of NHL players, it's changing now, but in the past, you know, guys would retire, have a lot of money in the bank, but have nothing to do with it. And it could be a real, real struggle. And, you know, I'm proud to say that I was the last player on the national team to get a university degree. All of my other teammates had one. And so usually women, when they leave sport, they do quite well because they've lined things up. And so I had medicine sort of lined up for a few years as I knew my career was winding down. And fortunately, I was able to get in and here I am.
Wow. You know, when you and I were first in touch about spending this time together talking tonight, we had a short exchange about medicine and medical culture. And I found myself thinking a lot about what your perspective has to offer and what it must have been like for you coming from a background where, you know, you excelled and the emphasis was on performance and excellence, and then coming into medicine. So I would love to hear some of your first pass observations, both at the beginning of your training and now, about what you personally have observed to be curious about medical culture.
Well, that's a good question. Yeah, there's a lot. I mean, initially, I would say coming from hockey into medicine, there's a lot of very similar parallels. So you're in a team sport most of the time. You should be working, you know, working together, high stakes, high decisions. Obviously, medicine is far greater with people's lives on the line. But I truly can say I will never feel as much pressure in medicine as I felt in my hockey and my athletic career. It just will never be like that for me. I know that because literally for 23 years, I felt the weight of the nation on my shoulders and playing for Canada. I don't feel the weight of a nation on my shoulders in medicine, but I feel the gravity of decision making, especially moving into residency and actually being able to put in orders and make some decisions, which is slightly horrifying. But there is this this beauty for me from going from being an expert in one field to a complete rookie in another. And so I really love that. I love going to the hospital every day and saying, I don't know. What I do notice is, and it's probably because I'm older, I've had a life before this, and I am very used to pressure. What I do notice is I think there are a lot of early trainees in medicine who are afraid to fail, afraid to make mistakes, because there's this constant looming judgment and constant evaluation that resides over medical trainees that can be really, really stressful. And so I was able to probably unburden myself from that early on because I came in with a different perspective, probably a lot more confident. And I'm also used to failing. In hockey, in sport, every day I went to the rink or to the gym, someone was always telling me what I needed to get better at. Mm-hmm. And I'm, you know, it's just part of second nature. You know, you need to shoot the puck, make the play here, you know, do something better, lift more weight. And you just get used to being told you just need to be better all the time. And in medicine, that's also what tends to happen. Some people don't deliver it as nicely as others. But I would say that the people that generally, I think, excel in medicine are the ones that are able to handle and embrace the criticism. So I try to not look at it as you know, someone criticizing me. They're just telling me some good feedback and information, and I'm going to use it to propel myself forward. So failing forward, I suppose, is a huge thing in medicine. I definitely felt early on, I have to say, how unhealthy I find medicine and medical school. I was sitting in these lecture halls for hours on end, and to the point where I actually got up and went and stood at the back because I couldn't take it anymore. And then I started to podcast every lecture I could because I could ride my bike and listen to it, and I could learn. And so I think medicine is a little bit hypocritical in the sense of we preach health and lifestyle, but the people inside of it don't always have that. And so I was on obstetrics a couple of weeks ago, and I was laughing with some of the staff doctors that, you know, one thing that I promise as an athlete, you're always worried about how you eat, how much you sleep, and going to the bathroom is a thing. And in medicine, nobody eats, nobody sleeps, and nobody pees. I said, I'm going to actually go to the bathroom right now. So, there's definitely some shifts. I think medicine could take a lot from a lot of areas in life and business, but as well, you know, sport can learn a lot from medicine. Some of the incredible empathy, the way people communicate with each other on a good day is incredible to see. So it can take both ways.
It's funny because at the beginning of the broadcast, we were also talking about you being on pediatric nephrology, and what you just made me think of with, you know, this kind of medicine's override, you know, so you learn all the physiology, but implicit in that learning is this message, well, it doesn't apply to you. You know, you don't need a break. So, but here's how the normal human works.
Yeah, I had a joke with a nephrologist actually yesterday. I was working, it was like 9 till 12 constant. And then I got up and I said, I think I'm going to go to the bathroom because that's good for our kidneys. And they all laughed. I probably give myself several AKIs in med school.
I have to argue with that reasoning when you're on nephrology.
Yeah, no, there's always lots of water around on nephrology.
Hayley, another thing that, you know, you just made me think of in terms of your perspective, you know, you obviously were an unparalleled success in a heavily male-dominated sport. Mm-hmm. And your perspective, you know, coming into medicine, I wonder, did that feel like sort of deja vu, you know, because you know that we, of course, as I'm sure you've observed and as many of our viewers know, we have major problems as well with gender imbalance and power imbalance and sexism in medicine and training. What are some of your thoughts about that aspect of medical culture?
Yeah, it exists. It also exists in hockey. I think it's getting better. But, you know, the majority of my life was spent as a female in a male-dominated world. So I was a little girl playing on all boys teams. Then I was a woman playing professional men's hockey, still having my own dressing room after all those years, dealing with generally through the course of my life, people saying, you know, you don't belong, do something else. And then you go into medicine and it's not so much you don't belong, do something else, but there's a bit of a gender bias, especially in specialties. I think when you go into surgery or, you know, other specialties where it's heavily male dominated, you know, I was having a conversation with a resident yesterday, and I think I'm probably 15 years older than she was. And so the tables kind of turned. I mean, I'm a med student, she's a resident. So on a medicine side, she very much teaches me. But from sort of a life skills side, we had this conversation about, you know, owning your space and being strong enough to dish it right back when it's given out. And I think there's a hierarchy in medicine that sometimes a fear-based culture that doesn't allow people to call people out. And I've experienced it myself. I used to shadow in an emergency department. And when I would go there, this one specific male doctor would always say, what are you doing here? You should have a hockey stick in your hand. And every time I walked into the department and I saw him, I'd be like, oh, here we go. And he said it. Keep saying it. So when I finally got into medicine, I was in med school. He said it again. He just kept chirping me. And I finally had enough. And I turned around and I said, you know what? You're absolutely right. I don't know anything about medicine, but like, give me about 8 years and I am so going to kick your butt. He never said a word to me after that. So I probably have a different mentality in the sense that, you know, I don't let people speak to me in those realms. And but if I was 20 years old starting medicine, I'm not sure that I could say the same thing, because someone is holding your career in the balance. I think there is this intimidation and this you know, sort of talking down sometimes that exists, and certainly this male female you know, lopsidedness. But I have to say, I've met some incredible male physicians through my med school career, and I have probably 5-6 women who have single-handedly gotten me through med school, you know, residents and attending physicians that have just been awesome, and watching them in their realms, they give me hope because they don't stand for anything. And so I think there's strength in numbers. And I think, you know, for if you're a resident or med student out there listening now, I mean, it's okay to, you know, to speak your truth and own your space, and nobody should ever be penalized for that.
When you talk about this hierarchy that we have in medicine that is so baked into our rituals and our concept of whose voice is authoritative and how we can ask questions and challenge people, just when you were speaking about that, I found myself thinking about the difference between that relationship, you know, what it's often like for us when we're learners or more junior with our preceptors versus what your relationship must have been like over the years and your wide variety of relationships, both as coachee, so someone being coached, and also as a captain. Like, how do you, what are some of your thoughts about where, you know, doing a makeover on that sort of preceptor role and updating it with some of those more useful relational models?
Yeah, well, I just think it, the best leaders and the best teachers. So as a student, as a med student, I found I'm going to never forget those great teachers I encountered through medicine, but I'm also never going to forget the bad ones. And there's a fair share of both. And I think that people in powerful positions and leaderful positions have to really understand that you have the ability to dramatically impact and chart someone's life. Like, even just with a comment or an interaction, you can change someone's life. And that's such a powerful thing and can be used for incredible good. And so the best teams and team environments that I've been on, I think, have been a collaborative environment. And so when I see in medicine, it's sometimes like, okay, the preceptor speaks and no one else speaks. And then, yes, we agree with you, or, you know, there's this sort of bowing down. But I've also worked with great physicians who kind of have this open environment, and they're not so maybe insecure or intimidated to be challenged by a med student or a resident. And they do it in such a way that I think is a good learning environment for everyone. And it just always reminds me that those are the best hockey teams that I've also played on, where the best coach I ever had, the door was always open, you know, to their office. You could go in, you could ask a question without fear of losing ice time or retribution. And then as a captain as well with the national team, I think what I learned through the years was like the ability to sometimes lead from the front, which you have to do in medicine, because as a trainee, you don't know much. And so sometimes you need to be dragged along. But then sometimes is the ability to sit back and let others and lead from behind and let other people rise up and do the job and have success and empower them. And, you know, I think the best physicians and experiences I've been in medicine are those which are exactly the same in hockey. And so I think this idea of this collaborative approach, this open door, non-intimidation, you know, being able to work towards a common goal, those are the best environments that I've ever been a part of.
Thinking about the medical environment and what it's like to work in it, we know that today is the Bell Let's Talk campaign today. And I know that you have spoken as a leader about mental health issues before and increasing the transparency around those dialogues. We also know that in medicine, as I know you're very familiar with, we have the highest suicide rate of completed suicide of a white collar profession. We also have this deleterious thing that happens to medical students. We know that matriculating or early medical students just before they begin have better mental health than their age matched peers. And then as they enter into medical school, we assess that a few years later and something deteriorates. And I'm so interested to hear, we talked about some of your observations about culture and perfection, but what's your take on medicine's hang up when it comes to acknowledging the importance of our own mental health and also the issues that we sometimes experience with it?
Well, I mean, you're right. Like just reading about the, I believe it was a cardiologist and then a emergency physician in Quebec, the last couple of weeks that have taken their own lives. And it's awful to see. I know personally a resident that passed away a couple of years ago as well. So it's very impactful. I think it comes down to this culture of, and this structure of medicine. And as I said earlier, I'm not sure that medicine allows for health maintenance. I find that I fight every day to carve out, and I'm like, you know, not apologetic, but I carve out time to work out, and I will not stay up till midnight every night studying. I have to sleep. And so I just have this maybe inner confidence that it's going to work out for me. But I think because of the experiences I've had in the past, but I think as a young student, when you start medicine or anyone who starts medicine, maybe without living in a pressure cooker like I have, and maybe not having built up as much inner resiliency, you come in and there's this constant feeling that you have to be perfect on everything. And I'll tell you, I was a very good student in high school and university. I had close to a 4.0 average. And quite honestly, in medical school, it's pass or fail in our medical school. And for me, it's MPL plus one, minimum passing level plus one. What can I do to just get through this rotation? Because I know that in the grand scheme of things, me getting a 75 or a 95 on this exam is going to mean absolutely nothing to how I'm going to practice medicine. It's more about, am I going to take care of myself, my health? How am I going to interact with patients? And the global skills is how I see it. Mm-hmm. And so I think we over-evaluate in medical school. I think there's this constant looming like pressure to always be performing. I think that's very hard on people. I'd love to see more I know it maybe isn't possible because of human resources, but you know, bedside evaluations and teaching and sort of those types of things versus, you know, exams all the time. You know, the other thing is that the hours. I remember I pulled in my first 3 weeks of clerkship, I had I worked 20 hours, and in 20 hours I got 20 minutes off, and I went to the bathroom once in 20 hours and I ate once in 20 hours, and I didn't know any different. I was just starting out. And I remember I went home and a couple days later I was just so slammed. I also had 4 codes that same night that I had gotten paged to and had really no idea what I was doing. I was like my first 3 weeks of clerkship. And I remember coming home a couple of days later after I kind of recovered, because you feel like you're almost, as you well know, jet lagged. I remember thinking, I will never do that to myself again. Like I must eat and drink, and I have to find a way to like get outside for a walk for 5 minutes. And I just thought, this is so incredibly unhealthy. We know what's right, but the system doesn't allow us the structure to set up for those long hours. So I just think working in medicine, there's this badge of honor. I put in all these hours. It doesn't necessarily mean it's quality or it's good care. It's very counterproductive. I mean, we value our sleep in hockey and an elite Olympic sport. I mean, you need 10 hours plus to basically perform at your best. And mm-hmm. I don't understand in medicine how people can be performing with anything less than quality care of themselves. So that really concerns me, and it bothers me a lot.
Mm-hmm. I love how you just phrased that. Like it's this healthy response of, I will not do that to myself, you know. And sometimes what you've just talked about and described, it's like we slowly, it's the erasure of our concept of what is normal and appropriate. You know, it's like going deeper and deeper into an imaginary delusional world where you have to, you know, stay up for 24 hours to do this or that. And it's just that healthy, reflexive, self-protective thing that you just described.
Yeah, and there's a lot of like busy work that doesn't result in anything, I find too. A lot of wasted time. That I come from a world in sport, I think, where every moment counts and every minute counts. You're always fighting to recover and to prepare and be at your best. And I find sometimes in medicine things really just can drag on, and like, why does the resident need to stay and write these notes? Are these really necessary? You know, like it's just like all busy work. And I'm like, there's got to be a better way. But you know, that's just my perspective.
You know, when you think about this concept of sustaining high performance, you know, it's such a common topic these days, talking about physician burnout and healthcare worker burnout. And you know, we talked about some of the contributing factors, but before we move into talking about some of the other fixes, I just wanted to ask you, did you have times in your athletic life when you experienced burnout? And what, you know, how did you kind of get through that, are there any lessons learned that you think apply to healthcare as well?
Yeah, I definitely, before the 2010 Olympics, I actually completely tanked myself, overtraining and overreaching. They're two sort of similar but different things. And I was sort of actually in sort of the overtrain stage where our physiologist said, you need to go home and lay on the couch for 1 week and not move. You are essentially just burnt in every way. And I really was like completely exhausted. I ended up getting pneumonia before the Olympics. It was a nightmare. And so it was sort of the middle of my career, and early on in my career, I wasn't a big fan of resting because I was young and I thought I never needed to rest. And now I take those rest days like they're gold, right? And I remember one of my friends, Ryan Smith, played for the Edmonton Oilers. And I'll never forget the one day he said to me, standing outside of the Saddle Dome in Calgary, he said, you know, Hayley, rest is a weapon. And I remember that, like in that 2010 year, that I am just going to lay on this couch and rest is going to be my weapon. And I am going to come back out of this tank and have the greatest performance ever in the 2010 Olympics. So I had sort of several moments like that through my career where I would get burnt out. And what I would do is, you lose the joy, you get irritated, you're tired, everything bothers you. Those are sort of signs and symptoms for me anyways. I go back to what I love. So for me, when it was hockey, I would go to the outdoor rink and I would play with kids and I would just put my skates on and just fool around. And it would remind me of, okay, this is why I play the game, because this is why, you know, in the little girl in Saskatchewan growing up, this is what I did and why I loved it. And in medicine, when I get a little bit like that, I need to go see human beings. And especially now in COVID, when we do so much Zoom and, you know, you often are stuck on the computer, when I start to get burnt out, I need to go and talk to people and interact with someone and in my little brain feel like I might have helped them in some way. And that gives me joy and that fills me up and that reminds me, this is why I went into medicine, is to help people, because so much of medicine is not like that. And so I think that, you know, burnout is a real thing and it's just about connecting back to like what brings you joy and what is your ultimate, you know, purpose of why you did this. And if you can't find that, then it's probably time to move on to something else.
You know, when you talk about, you were speaking a moment ago about what we're experiencing with COVID and some of the isolation and some of the, the impact on our relationships and our connections to each other. And I think one of the things that, of course, doesn't just apply to healthcare workers, it's to everybody on the planet right now. We're all in various stages of grief in terms of dealing with this new way that things are and that the mm-hmm. way that they are going to be for the foreseeable future. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I wonder from all the years that you were on this cycle of pre, during, and post Olympics and all the things that you experienced during that time, you know, what are some of the adaptations that you learned to, you know, change, to disappointment, or just sort of some of the cognitive reframing during some of those experiences that was particularly helpful to you?
Yeah, that's a great question. Well, I went into my first Olympics in 98 as a 19-year-old kid that thought we were going to win a gold medal. And I never once thought about losing. And standing on the blue line at the end of that gold medal game, I had a silver medal around my neck and those darn Americans had the gold around theirs. And I remember I was standing there and I was thinking two things, you know, I'm not going to let them see me cry. I'm going to do that somewhere else. And then the second thing I was thinking was, I never want to feel this way again. And it was about, and this is a very, very common thing, happens to a lot of athletes, an Olympic hangover, an Olympic depression, because as you can imagine, you go from a life where you're quite a normal person to this amazing, you know, living, you know, nobody's super rich and, you know, all of these types of things. Then you go to the Olympic Games, which is 4 years and this pinnacle of your life. And these 2 weeks or maybe a month or more that are just amazing. And then you come home again. And I remember particularly after the gold medal in Vancouver, I came home after celebrating in a sea of thousands of people the night before, winning gold for Canada with the men and women's teams. Came in the front door, nobody was home, and I thought, it was dead silent, and I thought, oh my gosh, I have to make lunch for my son for school tomorrow, and I have to do laundry. And life was over as I knew it as this, like, you know, this Olympic champion. And so it comes and it goes, very fleeting. And so in my first Olympic Games, when we lost, I went into this depression for about 6 months, and because everything that I thought I was wrapped up in who I was as a hockey player. So if we were winning and I was scoring goals and we were having success, then I was a good person and I was worthy. And if we weren't, then I was a failure. And I had no ability to separate the two. And I went to the rink one day, and my coach at the time, Wally Kozak, he gave me this quote, and it said, "A gold medal is a wonderful thing, but if you're not enough without it, you'll never be enough with it." Mm-hmm. And I folded this piece of paper up, and I literally, I keep it in my wallet, and I've had it with me for over 20 years. And I used to tape it in my hockey stall when we would play in different big games through the years as a reminder that it's just a hockey game. So the learning I got out of 98 was to equally think about winning and losing, which is kind of how I've approached this whole COVID thing, is that, yes, there's devastation. I see people pass away quite often from COVID or other things in my new life now. But I tend to look at life from the glass half full. And so I try to find the joy and the gold and the positivity in all of it. And then I think the second thing that I learned out of losing in order to learn how to win was how to let things go and how to not carry them. And I think that's really important thing in life and in medicine as well, and the ability to control what you can and let go of what you can't. And I think athletes are some of the most resilient humans on the planet, because there's so many things that happen to you as an athlete that you can't control that you want to, especially trying to peak for that one day every 4 years when the world is watching. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of pressure that can come for that moment. And I see similar things in medicine, you know, in different small ways. But I think by framing it, looking at it from 30,000 feet versus like right here, you can gain more perspective, which I didn't have when I was 19, that I now have, you know, 25 years later, having gone through all of that. So those are the types of things that I think about now. And it's all about just adapting and being able to change, I think, as well as things come at us.
And then Hayley, as we look forward, so we talked about some of the problems that plague medicine, some of the things that we know are actually counterproductive that are baked in or built into the culture. Mm-hmm. You know, you've made all kinds of strides in terms of, you know, your role as a woman in a male dominated sport, like we talked about, and just some of the other change that you've affected. What do you think is the mindset that we need to make some of the post-COVID changes in how we practice medicine and how we do some of these much needed reframes of medical culture? How do you think about that?
Well, you know, it was great having chatted with you a little bit before the show started about, I was just asking Dr. Horton for the audience about masks. Do you think we'll ever, you know, we'll never as physicians ever not wear masks again? And I do think like we'll probably forever be wearing masks. It just kind of makes a lot of sense given what we know now. So like from practical things like masks and better hygiene, but then into other things like time management. So, you know, now shifting to a lot of Zoom, like do we really need to show up in person for a grand rounds or for some of these endless meetings that seem to happen in medicine? Can we be more productive with time? Like where are areas where we can give people their time back? Because I'm a big believer that it's not about this quantity of time, it's about the quality of time. And giving people back some space, I think is really important. Do we, as you said earlier, do we need to constantly bring patients into the hospital or the clinic, or could we be more efficient use of our time and resources? From a bigger picture thinking, you know, for the next pandemic, because there will be one, maybe not in our lifetimes, but who knows when, are we going to have our long-term care homes in a much better place that we aren't going to senselessly lose thousands and thousands of our, you know, people that have built this country. It bothers me to no end to see what is going on with long-term care in this country. And are we going to be able to protect the vulnerable and the, you know, the less fortunate, those types of things? Like, are we really going to learn from this? Are politicians going to learn to step out of the way and let the experts really do the job and step in a more meaningful way moving forward? Those are the kinds of things that I wonder about moving forward. And then ultimately just for society and for people in general, are we going to learn to just, maybe not myself included, take things so much for granted, you know, in terms of, you know, the family and the health. And, you know, we only get one life on this planet and we only get one chance with our health. And I think for a lot of people in this pandemic, it's been a real wake-up call to take care of yourself and the people around you. So certainly for me and, you know, lots of people that I've spoken to.
So when we look at this incredible perspective that you have and this phenomenal past experience and the voice that you have, you know, people want to hear what you think, and you have such a fascinating, intersecting way of looking at things with your experience as a talk to your athlete and now as a physician. What are some of your dreams for, let's say, 10 years from now, how you may have been able to use your personal influence to change some of these things that we've talked about? What are sort of one or two or three targets that you have for things that you would like to leave different than they are right now?
Well, I think the one that I always think about, because this has been such a part of my life, is, you know, movement is medicine. And we have a culture now, our obesity rates are through the roof, and sedentary, especially during this pandemic, it's been hard, I think, for some people to get, you know, the activity they need. But the human body is amazing. And the human body, I believe, can heal in a lot of ways itself, given the right environment, the right food, the right nutrition, all of those types of things. And so I just would love to see medicine move to a more proactive promotion and prevention model versus this reactive model that I think it seems to be in our system. So that would, those kinds of things would be at the forefront for me. And then maybe the health and wellness of physicians and people in the system, given anything that I know, probably being an expert as an athlete in health and wellness, is, you know, people need, I think, the ability to change the culture to care and take care of one another and really engage with people. At the end of the day, you know, all we have when I think we leave the earth is the relationships that we have with others and the legacy that we leave. And, you know, I just think that could be a little bit more maybe at the forefront and taking care of the people that take care of people moving forward in medicine.
I want to ask you one more thing. There's so many healthcare workers, I'm sure, who are listening to you speak and finding inspiration and new thoughts in your words and your framing. And if you could sort of express one or two thoughts to Canadian healthcare workers that might give them comfort right now, looking forward into the uncertainty that we're dealing with, what are those things? What would that thought be for you?
Well, the first thing I would say is thank you. I know one of the things I think, if you're smart as a medical student, you learn early on in medicine is you gotta listen to the nurses, and you've got to treat the people around you that can really help you with a lot of respect and kindness, because those are the people that are going to save your bacon when you need it the most. And so what I find is when I walk through the hospital and I see the porters or the janitors, the nursing staff, and just the people that like make the whole thing happen in healthcare, I sometimes get kind of emotional, because I think, you know, these are the people that are a little bit maybe sometimes lost and forgotten. And if there's anything this pandemic has brought to the forefront, is the burden and the difficulty that the job is on most days, not just in a pandemic. So what I would say is, you know, you're not forgotten about, that's for sure. And I think to know that you have people around to lean on and times for support. And it's really important to find kind of those people for you in this and just stick close together. And, you know, there's nothing selfish or wrong with taking care of yourself first before you take care of other people. In fact, that's the most important thing to do, because that's how you're going to give the best care. So be kind to yourself, be compassionate, you know, just give yourself a break, because this has been hard enough on all of us, and to all the healthcare workers and people out there on the front lines. That's a broad term, but thank you very much for what everyone has done so far.
Well, I'm going to say on behalf of all of them, I think it's pretty amazing that we get to claim you as one of us now. So that has already lifted my spirits talking to you this evening. So Hayley, our time is almost up today. And before we close out, one thing I would love to ask you, you are a figure of so much influence and have such love and respect among Canadians. I would love to hear what your hopes are for how the average Canadian, healthcare worker or not, is going to, you know, the choices that people are going to make around COVID. What do you want to see? Is there anything you would like to say to people about vaccination? Any thoughts you'd like to share about that right now?
It's a bit of a long, convoluted story, but I was fortunate to receive the first dose of the vaccination on a pre-approved core rotation that all medical students that had them were granted during COVID. So when I was working in the Guelph region, everyone where I was working had received the vaccine. So I did receive the first dose. I have no idea if or when I'll receive the second one. It's not looking like it's going to happen given the state of this. But I would say to people, I didn't experience any problems with it. It worked. I had a sore arm. I would encourage everyone to please get vaccinated. It, I think, is one of the easiest ways that we are going to get through this pandemic. But, you know, it's like a plane analogy, whether you're at the front of the plane or the back of the plane. When we get off the plane, we still have to wait for our bags. And it doesn't matter if you're vaccinated now or 3 months from now, until at least 60-70% of us get vaccinated, it's not really going to have the effect that we need it to have. So nothing changes in my world. Having one dose, I still am worried. My parents live next door to me. I sincerely don't want to kill my parents. It's a thought I have. They're in their 70s. When I think about, I am tired from this pandemic, like everyone else. I am sick and tired of not being able to see my nieces and go to the outdoor rink and do all those things. And some days I'm like, forget it, I'm going to do it. And then I think, I'm not going to kill my mom and dad. And, you know, and I think that's what we have to think of. Find someone in your life that you're going to do it for. If you don't want to do it for yourself because you're tired and you're sick of it, it is really important and it does matter. And collectively as a nation and as a group, like if we all just find a way to do it, we're going to get through this much faster than if we don't. And take care of each other, take care of yourself, and find the hope, find the light in these crazy times, for sure.
Yeah, I love it. And I would also just echo what you said. I was fortunate enough to have as a frontline worker, the second dose of my vaccine actually today. I feel great, no side effects, absolutely nothing. So just like you, so deeply hoping for that excellent uptake as soon as soon as our fellow Canadians have the opportunity to be vaccinated as well. Well, Hayley Wickenheiser, soon to be Dr. Hayley Wickenheiser, I am so grateful to you for taking time out of your schedule today. This is an hour that you could have been learning pediatric nephrology. Such things as the fractional excretion of sodium that we talked about. We'll come back. We'll do an hour on that another day. But really, your time is precious and needs to be protected. So I am so grateful, just as I know all of our listeners in the series are tonight, to you for taking your time to talk to us as fellow Canadians and as healthcare workers about just sharing your insights and your wisdom. I've learned a ton. It's been amazing. So thank you so much.
Well, thanks for having me, Dr. Horton, and to everyone out there, thanks for listening, and stay safe, stay sane, and we'll get through this together for sure. So thank you for having me.
Thank you. And I am Dr. Jillian Horton. I'm a general internist in Winnipeg, Manitoba, and a writer. And I am the host of Arts, Medicine, Life at the National Arts Centre, being hosted on our digital platform in Ottawa, Canada. And just before we finish up tonight, I would like to say thank you again to Hayley Wickenheiser, to the wonderful team at the National Arts Centre who make production possible on the digital platform, and to our generous sponsors, the Canadian Medical Association, Scotiabank, and MD Financial Management, who make all of this possible. And if you have the opportunity, I would love to invite you to join us for the next installment of the series happening February 24th. It is actually the national book launch of my book about medicine, medical education, mindfulness, and many other things. It is called We Are All Perfectly Fine and will be released by HarperCollins Canada on February 23rd. And in the meantime, thank you so much for joining us tonight. It is a pleasure and a privilege to have your time. Stay safe, take care of yourselves, and we'll see you again next month. Good night.
This has been a National Arts Center podcast. Send us your comments and questions. Email us at nacpodcasts@gmail.com. Visit the podcast section of the iTunes store, where you can rate and comment on this podcast. We love to hear from you. Remember, you can find more great NAC podcasts at nacpodcast.ca or search on National Arts Center on iTunes and subscribe for free. Until next time, goodbye from Canada's National Arts Center.